Today on BRStv Investigates, how long can you store your mixed saltwater? Hi, I'm Randy, a host for the YouTube series BRStv Investigates, where we take popular reefing theories, methods, questions, and products, and dive even further than what the manuals and packaging will tell you in order to put them to the test in real-world environments, rate them on our scale of reef fantasy to reef certainty, and share with you, the reefing community, what we find. Today, we continue our testing of some of our most popular salt mixes by answering the common question of, will alkalinity and calcium levels in freshly mixed salt water drop or precipitate during storage? Meaning that if I choose a specific salt brand based on the levels for alkalinity and calcium they provide after mixing a batch to my target salinity of 1.026 specific gravity or 35 parts per thousand, how long can I store that batch of salt water and trust that those levels won't shift to a point that I would need to adjust them back? So for those reefers who are making small batches of water and using it rather quickly after mixing, worrying about the alk and calcium parameter shifting is likely less important to you. However, for a growing number of reefers who like to mix larger batches less frequently and use them over longer periods of time, or for those who are using stored salt water in auto water change bins, it would definitely be nice to know if your salt mix's alkalinity and calcium were stable from beginning to end. In order to determine just what happens to mixed salt water over time during storage, we plan to test the same 8 most popular salts on our site that we used in our test for cost per gallon analysis with the Tropic Marin Pro and Classic, Brightwell Neo Marine, Red Sea Coral Pro and Blue Bucket, HW Reefer, and both Instant Ocean Standard and Reef Crystal salts. We'll mix up 20 gallons of each salt brand to the most commonly targeted 35 parts per thousand or 1.026 specific gravity and take their initial batch readings immediately after mixing, 2 hours later, 4 hours later, and at a full 24, 48 hours, and also at the 1, 2, and 3 week storage mark. In order to remove outside variables like temperature and water circulation, we plan to only mix each batch of salt water until they're visibly clear at a room temperature of 67 degrees, then leave them loosely sealed without further circulation and heating, much like storing the salt water at room temp in a loosely sealed container like a brute trash can with a lid. The biggest thing to note here is that for these tests, we are using the same hobby grade test kits that many reefers also use at home, so there should be some expectation of accuracy margin with their test results, which will probably be plus or minus a half a DKH point for alkalinity and plus or minus 10 to 15 parts per million in calcium. This accuracy range and margin for error are within the test kit's accuracy range, with some added room for minor procedural inconsistencies and subjective endpoint readings, and due to that, we'd likely see some type of fluctuations in the results, but I expect the answer will still be clear regardless and end up providing us with a window into some of the readings you would get at home using the same test kits and procedures. Let's start looking at the results of this test by starting with the changes in calcium for each of the 8 salt mixes, which, as you'll see, don't really tell a jaw-dropping story when looking at the overall change for each salt, and most are within the plus or minus 10 to 15 parts per million testing margin, and some are even tighter than that. Again, I'd note that this is a hobby-grade test kit that uses a color change indication as to the concentration levels in the sample, so we do have to reasonably expect that the endpoint is going to be somewhat subjective based on methodical testing procedure and individual interpretation of the exact moment that the reagent causes a full change in sample color. And before we get too far into the results, I wouldn't expect to see a substantial drop in calcium due to precipitation, because calcium is more abundant in the water column versus alkalinity to the tune of about a 7-to-1 ratio. Meaning that for every change up or down in one full DKH point, on average the calcium would only change about 7 parts per million, so pretty insignificantly in comparison, and likely why alkalinity would be the more determinative factor when showing swings throughout the duration of storage. Starting with the Tropic Marin Pro results, we see that immediately after mixing, we get a start point of 400 parts per million, and at the end of 3 weeks in storage, we get 410 parts per million, which is just a difference of 10, and still inside of our 10 to 15 parts per million testing margin. The average of the readings ends up being 413 parts per million, and what I would consider to be a negligible or zero change. The Tropic Marin Classic salt ended with similar results over 3 weeks, with a starting point of 400 parts per million and ending at 415, and still within our margin for error for the hobby grade testing. Along with that, and similarly to the Tropic Marin Pro, we see an average of only 411, leaving this salt pretty much unchanged over the entire testing period. Brightwell's Neil Marine is up next, and again we see this pretty flat set of results, starting with 390 parts per million calcium and ending at 400, with the overall average coming in at 393, which is only a surprising 3 parts per million deviance from the start point. HW Reefer showed slightly different results than the previous three, testing at 450 parts per million right after mixing, and then ending 25 parts per million lower after 3 weeks at 425. Which is about an overall drop in calcium of 10 parts per million when factoring out our 10 to 15 margin of error, and pretty darn close to being another salt mix that seems to hold steady over time. Let's take a look at the Red Sea Blue Bucket next, which tells a similar tale to the previous salts, with a 400 start point and 410 end point for an overall deviation of less than our margin of error. Red Sea Coral Pro is next, and right away we see a pretty noticeable drop in calcium, where right after mixing we see an initial reading of 495 and after 3 weeks an end point leveling out at 430 for an overall change of 65 parts per million. The largest difference in calcium comes within the initial 4 hours, with a fall from 495 to 440, and given that Coral Pro is absolutely an elevated salt mix, it's probably not surprising to many reefers with elevated levels of alkalinity and calcium both, we see some noticeable drop due to precipitation shortly after mixing, and also likely why Red Sea themselves recommend mixing for 30 minutes to 2 hours, but no more than 4 in total. The results for Instant Ocean Standard are roughly on par with a majority of the other salt mixes tested, with a 400 parts per million start point and an end at 385, which gives it an average of 387 parts per million and the lowest overall calcium level out of the group, likely due to the two relatively low readings that came in at 375 parts per million. Rounding out the calcium testing is the Instant Ocean Reef Crystals that states has purposely elevated calcium levels and shows in the testing where it started at 500 parts per million and ended 10 parts per million lower at 490, with an average across all points at 489. Moving on to Alkalinity, where we'll likely see a clearer picture as how each salt holds up in storage, as changes in DKH are more noticeable over calcium, likely due to its lesser availability in the water column, where more subtle changes should be easier to see. Again, starting with the Tropic Marin Pro, we see almost a completely flat line over 3 weeks of storage, with the Alk starting at 6.9 DKH right after mixing, and only fluctuates a maximum of 3/10 of a DKH point throughout the entire test, which is well under our 0.5 DKH testing margin. Tropic Marin Classic shares a somewhat similar path, beginning at 8.9 DKH alkalinity and ending 2/10 higher at 9.1. The largest swing overall was a difference of 0.6 DKH from the lowest test at 8.6 to the highest at 9.2, but when we factor in the half a DKH point for the testing margin, the overall change comes out to only a 1/10 of a point and not really a significant change at all. Much like the calcium test, Brightwell Neomarine looks to have the least amount of overall change, with a starting point of 7.7 and an ending point of 7.8, and throughout the entire 3 week period only changed in alkalinity by a pretty surprising 2/10 of a DKH point. HW Reefer wound up being another well-performing salt when it comes to maintaining parameters through storage, where it starts at an 8.7 DKH and ends just a 1/10 higher at 8.8. Much like Tropic Marin Pro, the overall change from HW's lowest to highest reading is only 3/10 of a DKH. Let's take a look at the Red Sea Blue Bucket salt mix, which shows a slight drop in alkalinity from its starting point of 7.9 to the end point of 7.3. We do see a slight increased peak at the 48-hour mark, where it hit 8.3 DKH, which is difficult to explain, but still within our 0.5 DKH margin of testing, but does come back down after 2 weeks of storage and ends with a 0.6 DKH difference from the beginning. The Red Sea Coral Pro again shows the largest change across all of the salts we tested, with the highest start point of 11.0 DKH and ending with a drop of 2.2 DKH in total at 8.8 DKH. Again, we see a slight increase at the 48-hour mark, as we did with the Blue Bucket, but as for the drop in alkalinity in general, I'd say that this is actually the type of performance that could be expected from elevated levels where the water is super saturated with alkalinity and calcium, which probably should fall over time. This is likely why Red Sea openly provides very specific mixing instructions, where you mix the salt unheated at around 68 degrees and for 2 hours max, absolutely no more than 4 hours, then heat to match the tank temp and use, making it a good option to use in a shorter period of time. Looking at instant ocean standard, again we see another salt with slightly elevated levels of alkalinity, which starts at 10.1 dKH immediately after mixing, and then ends surprisingly higher at 10.4, or 3/10 higher. Overall, from the lowest reading of 10.1 in the beginning to the highest at 10.6 at the 2-week mark, we see an increase of 0.5 dKH, which is within our testing margin, but still hard to explain. Similarly to the Red Sea Coral Pro, the Instant Ocean Reef Crystal shows purposely elevated levels for alkalinity and calcium. However, for the reef crystals, the alkalinity doesn't fall, but actually also seems to increase over storage, much like the Instant Ocean Standard did, from a start point of 10.6 dKH to an end point of 11.0. Again, it is hard to explain how the levels can climb, although it was within our testing accuracy range, but both Instant Ocean salts performed remarkably similar to each other with their increasing levels. Even harder to explain is how Reef Crystals is able to maintain higher alkalinity and calcium without any type of measurable drop in both parameters that would indicate precipitation. Okay, so to answer today's question of will alkalinity and calcium levels in freshly mixed saltwater drop or precipitate during storage, I'd actually rate this one a 2 on the reef fantasy scale, because it is pretty obvious to me that really most of them can be stored without issue, especially if left uncirculated and unheated as we did. Really, the only outlier here is the Red Sea Coral Pro salt, which seems to follow the expected path of results that one would guess when using salts with purposely elevated levels, yet I believe Red Sea would recommend not storing it for longer periods of time. All right, what does this mean for the average reefer who's looking to make larger batches of saltwater that will be used periodically for smaller percentage water changes, or in an auto water change situation like we use here at BRS for our BRS 160, Reefer 750 XXL, and Ryan's office tanks? Really, based on the storage conversation alone, I'd be pretty comfortable picking most of these salts and know that I can expect the same levels from the time it was initially mixed to the time I finally got around using it, or while it is being dosed slowly over a longer period of time with my auto water change reservoir. As long as we're able to mitigate evaporation by keeping the reservoir loosely closed and likely out of large temperature changes, pick a salt that matches your desired parameters and it will likely hold for you. So what's next in salt testing for BRStv Investigates episodes? Well, for those of you who require larger percentage water changes where not only are matching parameters for alkalinity and calcium of the display tank important, but also matching the temperature to reduce larger fluctuations being equally as important, we plan to take this test even further by running the same experiment, but in a temperature controlled tank at 78 degrees with the addition of circulation to find out if and how heat and flow affect the same alkalinity and calcium parameters for each of these salt mix brands, in an effort to determine whether some of these are cleaner than others and more or less likely to precipitate crust in the tank. Lastly, this wouldn't be a regular Friday BRStv episode without something to give away, so this week we have 2 Hanna Instruments professional reef test kits up for grabs, each valued at $230, so click the link in the lower left or head over to the site and click free prizes to sign up and win. Finally, head on over to our Reef to Reef post and vote on today's poll asking, how long do you store your mixed salt water? I'm interested to see if some decide to start storing theirs a bit longer. Stay tuned as we continue to explore and test even more reef myths and reef certainties around salt mixes. And if you have anything you'd like to see us test or questions about salt mixes in general, drop a comment below, share your ideas on the Reef to Reef thread, or better yet, jump on our hashtag AskBRStv Facebook group where the BRS crew, including Ryan and I, get in there and answer your questions. See you on the next BRStv.